Last night, two strong earthquakes struck northwestern Venezuela, causing damage and injuries. The first event was a magnitude 6.2 quake which struck at 6:21 p.m. local time at a spot 128 kilometers southeast of the city of Maracaibo. As the ground rapidly shook back and forth for around 9 seconds, some debris fell off of buildings, cracks formed in scattered structures, and in at least one case, a building seems to have completely collapsed. Then, 5.5 hours later, at 11:51 p.m. local time, an even stronger magnitude 6.3 earthquake struck 2.8 kilometers to the east, causing more intense ground motion than the prior quake, resulting in additional damage. What had just occurred was a rare instance of a so-called doublet earthquake, where one earthquake directly preceded an even larger magnitude event, meaning the 6.2 was a foreshock. While uncommon, the odds of any given earthquake representing a foreshock before a larger magnitude earthquake within a week's time span is about 5%. And yet, despite representing the largest earthquakes to have struck underneath mainland Venezuela since 1997, the damage for all intents and purposes was surprisingly limited, and there's a key reason for this. While many structures in South America are built out of unreinforced brick, which often fares poorly under significant earthquake strain, structures in Venezuela are largely built out of concrete. And not just ordinary concrete, but concrete that has been reinforced, making it uniquely suitable to come out of a larger magnitude earthquake with less severe damage than traditional concrete structures. This is why I interpret the current U.S. Geological Survey model damage estimates to be at least an order of magnitude too high in both categories, especially because no fatalities have so far been reported. Yet, back to the earthquake which struck, I want to note something strange which makes it scientifically interesting. The two earthquakes which struck occurred in incredibly close proximity to the major Valera Fault, a regional left lateral strike slip fault. Every other regional earthquake in close proximity to this fault generated motion that was perfectly consistent with this fault's motion, so you'd expect the two latest earthquakes to follow the same pattern. And yet, in an area where fault motion is dominated by the horizontal rather than vertical movement, these two quakes broke this trend. Instead of representing the motion of a strike slip fault, they both occurred on low-angle reverse faults. Albeit reverse faults that just so happened to parallel the adjacent strike slip fault with an oblique motion suggesting some part of the Valera fault actually did move in its expected manner. Thus, there are only two possibilities. One, the Valera fault actually bends to allow for oblique faulting to occur at certain depths, much like seen during California's 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake. Or two, there just so happens to be one, possibly two, unknown offshoots of the Valera fault buried at depth that are reverse faults. Whichever is the case, the reason for this unusual behavior is the same. You see that lengthy Valera fault? Only 5 million years ago, this strike-slip fault was in fact a reverse fault. Over long time scales, sometimes the motion of a specific fault line type can dramatically change. In other words, the reverse fault motion could simply be remnant stress and strain from the earlier geologic setting that originally created the Valera fault. But, going back to the damage of yesterday's two earthquakes, U.S. Geological Survey models suggest that some limited landslides occurred alongside more extensive, albeit only moderately widespread liquefaction. Thus, the reports I am seeing of some cracked roads and bridges are probably not due to the earthquake shaking in of itself, but rather liquefaction caused by it. A few aftershocks, large enough to be felt but most likely lesser in magnitude, are likely to occur during the next few days to weeks in the vicinity, but these generally happen at a decreasing rate over time. As a final note, I would like to thank this channel's patrons on Patreon and channel members on YouTube for supporting my work.